gave me a dead mic, so this time I had to make sure. Okay, so I wouldn't really say this is a sermon because this is going to be like 10 minutes long, 5 minutes long, I think. I don't know.
Go ahead with it.
So anyways, so I've done this before. Earlier in the year, Pastor Chad asked a couple of his youth to come up here and give devotionals for Sunday morning service. And I actually did this for one of them, and this time I'm going to do it a little bit different because, I mean, I felt like God just wanted me to share this again, except present it in a different way. So, I'm going to talk about Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So, the backstory behind these three fellows, was actually four, I'm going to include Daniel. See, King Nebuchadnezzar became king, and he became king over Babylon. And he had this empire. And so he's wanting the best servants he could possibly find. So he goes, and he's like, okay, go search for the best-looking men, strong, powerful, good-looking, and we're going to train them to become the best servants they could possibly be. So they go grab out some Israelites who they consider the best. Best looking, charming, handsome, just like me. I'm just kidding. So they train them. And no one stood out more than Daniel, Hananiah, Azariah, and Mishael. Also known as Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So they come, these great servants for this king. And King Nebuchadnezzar goes, all right, I will place you in high positions. So he does so with Daniel, and he anoints Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego as servants, as administrators over the province of Babylon. And so he's like, okay, so now I'm going to change your names. So, of course, he changed Hananias, Azariah, Mishael's to Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And that's where I'm going to go with this. So, who brought their Bible? Like, did anyone bring their Bible to this? Yours is up here.
Yeah, I've got mine up there.
That's besides the point. Did anyone else? I have, no support, guys. If you have your phone, I guess I'll count that, too.
Now you know how I feel.
Yeah. I guess I'm feeling the love here, guys. Like, no one brought their Bibles. No one came prepared.
You didn't get mine.
Oh!
Because you said you were going to leave it in the car.
Oh!
Anyways, that's besides the point. So if you have your phone, I guess we'll count that as a Bible. And, I'm feeling the love here. So, it's deep. I'm just kidding. So if you have your Bibles, turn to Daniel chapter 3. That's where I'm going to read. So I'll give y'all time to flip there. When you're there, say amen.
Amen.
I got to remember I don't have that much support. So is that everybody? Is everybody there?
Amen or on me.
Wait. Okay.
Three what?
Daniel chapter 3, verse 1. Is where we're gonna go. I'll make it easy on you. Okay. Alright. So King Nebuchadnezzar made an image of gold 90 feet high and 9 feet wide and set it up on the plain of Dura in the province of Babylon. He then summoned the satraps, prefects, governors, advisors, treasurers, judges, magistrates, and all the other provincial officials to come to the dedication of the image he had set up. So the satraps, prefects, governors, advisors, treasurers, judges, magistrates, and all the other provincial officials assembled for the dedication of the image that King Nebuchadnezzar had set up, and they stood before it. Then the herald loudly proclaimed, "This is what you are commanded to do, all peoples, nations, and men of every language. As soon as you hear the sound of the horn, flute, zither, lyre, harp, pipes, and all kinds of music, you must fall down and worship the image of gold that King Nebuchadnezzar has set up. Whoever does not fall down and worship will immediately be thrown into a blazing furnace." Therefore, as soon as they heard the sound of the horn, flute, zither, lyre, harp, and all kinds of music, all the peoples, nations, and men of every language fell down and worshiped the image of gold that King Nebuchadnezzar had set up. Now, if you would go down to verse 12, It says, but there are some Jews whom you have set over the affairs of the province of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who pay no attention to you, okay? They neither serve your gods nor worship the image of gold you have set up. Furious with rage, Nebuchadnezzar summoned Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, so these men were brought before the king. Now, at this point, we find, okay, so we have, out of everyone in this empire, only three people did not bow down. So we're thinking, what? Is there something wrong here? I mean, we have Israelites here, but yet, three. Out of all the people, three.
Right.
Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. All the officials were no exception to this. It doesn't say everyone will be thrown into a furnace except my officials and servants. No. Everyone is involved in this. There are no exceptions. And they knew this, but they still stood. So continuing on with verse 16, after they stood up, King Nebuchadnezzar gave them another chance. It says, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied to the king, O Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves before you in this matter. If we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God we serve is able to save us from it, and he will rescue us from your hand, O king. But even if he does not, we want you to know, O king, that we will not serve your gods or worship the image of gold you have set up. So first, they're only three out of everyone. So probably not looking around, they're like, okay, no one else is doing this, but so are we sure we're going to go through this? But then they go to the king. So the king tells them, okay, I'm giving you another shot. So in their mind, I'm going to do this a little earthly right now. They're probably thinking, okay, we can get out of here. I ain't going to get cooked. I ain't going to get involved in this. But then at the same time, they're like, okay, so we can either do this, serve the king, bow down, and we'll just ask God to forgive us later. We can do that route.
Come on now.
We can go, okay, we just completely bow down, forget about the whole thing, turn away. We can do that. But no. We can go, okay, so maybe we can just sneak out of here before, you know, anyone catches us. That way we ain't got to get involved in this. Did they do that? No. But what they do? They still stay there. Okay. We know what we believe in, and we're going to stand firm on this.
Right.
This is what we do. This is what we believe in. We're not bowing down to your gods.
Man.
We're not bowing down to any of that. I don't care what kind of chaos I'm about to face. I don't care. My God can save me.
Yes. Amen.
Even through all this chaos, they still stood and they had faith.
Amen.
So King Nebuchadnezzar got furious. He's like, okay, I'm going to throw you in this furnace. This furnace is so hot, even the guards that stood next to it got. That's how hot this thing is.
Yes.
So they're probably thinking as they get closer, okay, can we back up now? Like, should we go away? But in their mindset, they're still like, no, I'm going to keep moving forward. I'm not going to look back. The decision, I've already made that. I'm standing firm.
Right.
This is my decision, and this is what I believe in. So in verse 24, it says, then King Nebuchadnezzar leaped to his feet in amazement and asked his advisors, weren't there three men that we tied up and threw into the fire? They replied, certainly, O king. He said, look, I see four men walking around in the fire, unbound, unharmed, and the fourth looks like the son of the gods. Nebuchadnezzar then approached the opening of the blazing furnace and shouted, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, servants of the Most High God, come out, come here. So Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego came out of the fire, and the satraps, prefects, governors, and royal advisors crowded around them. They saw that the fire had not harmed their bodies, nor was a hair of their head singed. Their robes were not scorched, and there was no smell of fire on them. Absolutely.
Hallelujah.
They were complete and totally untouched.
Yes.
How? Why? Because they didn't lose faith. They knew that somebody had to stand for their God.
Right.
Somebody had to do it. Right. If it was just them three, they were going to do it.
Yes.
They weren't afraid. They're like, okay, I'm going to go in here. I'm just going to stand here. I don't care if I die there. I'm dying for a good reason. But I'm here. I'm standing here for my God. And this is what I'm doing. Verse 28. Then Nebuchadnezzar said, "Praise be to the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who has sent his angel and rescued his servants. They trusted in him and defied the king's command, and willing to give up their lives rather than serve or worship any god except their own god. Therefore, I decree that the people of any nation or language who say anything against the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, but these must return to no other god can save them this way." So by their faith, it changed an empire. So much for God.
That's it.
And a change happened just like that. Now they're saying, okay, if you defy their God, you're going to get cut into pieces. But that's not even that ironic part of the story. At the beginning of this, I said their names were changed. So let's look at the meaning of their names. Shadrach means servant of Achaia, which is a god that Nebuchadnezzar served. All these will be gods that Nebuchadnezzar served. Meshach was the shadow of the prince. And Abednego was a servant of Nego. That's what their names were changed to. The king changed their names to go along with the god that he served. But God didn't use Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego.
Right.
He didn't. He used Hananiah, which means the Lord shows grace.
Yes.
He used Michelle, which means who is equal to God. And he used Azariah, which means the Lord helps.
Yes.
You see,
hallelujah.
God didn't use Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. He didn't use what the king labeled them as.
Right.
He used their own people. He used the people who he had called at the very beginning. He used Hananiah, Azariah, and Michelle. Those were his people. They didn't care what they were labeled as. They were labeled by a king who believed in their gods, but they weren't for that. They said, "Look, I'm Hananiah, I'm Azariah, I'm Michelle. I'm a child of the one true king.
Yes.
So I'm going to stand for my God who named me at the very beginning, and I'm not going to worry about what the king labeled me. I'm going to serve them." And that's what they did.
Yes.
They didn't care what the world labeled them as. But instead, they labeled themselves as childs of the one true king.
Amen.
And that's how the revival happened.
Yes.
It didn't happen because they allowed the world to tell them what they were going to do.
Right.
They let them name them. But it happened because they stood for what they were. And they knew who they were.
Yes.
So,
amen.
I guess you can say this is a tag team sermon or a tag team devotional. So, since we're talking about the Bible now, I'm going to ask Jamie to come up and bring his sermon.
Amen.